We're here in Burgas. This is my mother-in-law and father-in-law. And for extra income, they make crab traps or fishing traps, just like this right here. The crab goes in through the cone, and then there's a flat plate that sits on top, and it would sit like that in the water with a piece of bait on it. And my mother-in-law, that's what she's making here, here's the bottom part right here. That's the bottom, and that would go on like that, and then you'd put your bait in there, and then put it in shallow water or deep water somewhere. How deep of water do you fish for crabs? Very deep or not so deep?
3 meters?
Three fathoms? So that would be about 18 or 20 feet, okay? So that's pretty deep. All right. So this is kind of like their little side business that they do here. And it's pretty fancy watching her. She uses a pattern. So she knows where to make the outside. This is something I would like to learn how to do. You need to give me a lesson someday. Now, this bamboo, this is the hard bamboo, the thorny bamboo. Thorn bamboo, okay. There's two main kinds of bamboo here, a thorny bamboo and a big thin wall bamboo. And the thorny bamboo is much harder. And it's just wicked to work around because all the little small branches are covered with, they're not really thorns, they're little teeny branches, but they'll go right through your shoe. They're just nasty as can be. And what part is he making? The round part for the center?
Yes.
Okay. Neat. We would call that the funnel. See, basic over, under, and then she bends it over. And that's something. How many fish traps have you made in your lifetime, you think? 1 million? Many. Very fancy. Two over. And one wrap around the two and back under. Two more over. Interesting. If I was going to buy a fish trap in the market, if I was going to buy this in the market, how much would that cost? 20 pesos? Okay, that would be about 50 cents per trap then. And everybody in our village here in Burgas, most of the people, they make crab traps because we have a big supply of bamboo in the bottomlands between here and the ocean. You go up two villages to the north, and everybody up there makes clay pots. And they make these things right here for cooking. I don't know what you call that. Because where they live at, there's a vein of sandy clay. And then you go to other villages and they'll be making straw hats or baskets or things like that. You know how to do that, Shannon? No? Huh. All right.
Bye.
Marfie's cooking me dinner. We're having rice and fried potatoes. That's how you cook here with wood fire. Takes a special talent to be able to do that. I can't do it. Here's our project this week. We enclosed the kitchen with strips of bamboo. We got all the bamboo off our property, so all we had to do was buy the nails. That's pretty nice, huh? Can you go in there?
No dogs.
No dogs in there, huh? That's good.
No. No.
All closed up.
No. No.
Oh, one more little thing. We helped a few guys with getting hooked up with a couple girls here in our area. Gave out a few names and addresses and everything, and they're communicating back and forth now. One of the guys mentioned that I have another video that's be coming out pretty soon on visas, and he mentioned that there is a quota visa for military people here. And that's something I never heard of before. I'm on a quota visa for being married, and my visa is only 320 pesos a year, something like that. It's $8 a year. If you come as a tourist, it'll cost you about $20 or $30 every 2 months for your visa, which is still really cheap, but just something to think about. And I also want to throw in a picture in this video of what it looked like back in February. And if you guys watch the tour of our property, you can see how dry everything is and how the plants are all kind of dying. I'm just going to put just a picture of what it looked like in February back when we were still getting rain. It's like night and day. Just thought I'd show that to you. Thanks. Check out this beetle here. He's hard to see him, but it's huge. He's got body's about 2 inches long, and he's got 4-inch antennae. He's cool looking. He's got camouflage spots on him. Real cool mandibles on him. Hi, Shannon.
Hi.
We got a little compass thing painted on the sidewalk here today. And the other night, Shannon and I were standing out here looking at the stars, and I showed her the Big Dipper up over the top of the mango tree here. And I showed her estimate using the stars in the Dipper, how to estimate about where the North Star would be at. So I had her make a mark on the cement that night, and we came out the next day with a compass and put it here in the cement, and she couldn't believe that was exactly north. So we used a garbage can and painted around the outside of it, and you know, put the northeast, south, and west on there. So now we have a nice little reference thing here. Stupid, I guess, for most people, but for us, we're big on directions and stuff. I showed the Boy Scout troop last year at the Jamboree how to find directions using the stick and shadow method. And we had the superintendent of Boy Scouts for the entire island at the jamboree, and he had no idea how to do that. He was, not if he was impressed, but he was surprised that you could just find something that simple out. So we're always doing little things like that. I have a new way of finding south, and that's using I'll show you my hand, using a vertical sundial. You put a stick or a matchstick between your first two fingers, and then when you point your hand towards south, the shadow will go in a certain direction. So you need to know the directions where the shadow will go, and then turn your hand until the shadow goes to the right area for the right time of the year, and it'll tell you exactly where south is. A guy sent me some pictures and stuff about that, and we're going to try to make a video to explain it to everybody. It's kind of complicated, but actually once you learn it, it's actually very simple. Here's something else we never showed the other day in the yard video. This is a kamungai tree, and my wife and family, when they make soup, they peel all these little leaves off and put those in the soup. Gives the soup a lot extra vitamin B and stuff. Oh, another thing I want to put in this video was I had two different things. I had some comments from some guys on my Philippine videos, and they told me I should put on like a donation box on the channel, and they said people would donate money. In fact, they said they would donate a few bucks to me here and there, and I asked my brother to look into it for me, and he sent me a webpage. I haven't checked it out yet. It sounds like a good idea, but I feel kind of like a beggar, you know. I don't like that idea so much. But anybody's got any comments on that, what they think about that? The other thing I wanted to ask was the balik buy-in boxes. I hear guys here, people here getting balik buy-in boxes sent to them. In fact, one guy laughed and made a joke saying in one of the comments, we should send that guy a balik buy-in box of green beans, something like that, which would be fantastic. Feel free to send it to me, you know. If you want to do that, send me an email and I'll send you my name and address. But does anybody know how you get in touch with this balik buy-in places? I asked my dad to look into it. He lives down in southwestern Florida, down by Naples, down there between Naples and Fort Myers, and he says he's never heard of it or never could find any information on it at all. And I know they're being real strict on the boxes now. It used to be able to send anything you wanted across on the balik buy-in boxes with no custom taxes or anything, but now they're opening all the boxes and x-raying them, and whatever you got in there that's worth anything, they're putting a tariff on them and making you pay customs on them. But it's still, it's the best way to ship anything. I had another American friend that said he used to ship stuff to himself. He'd go back to America and then he'd ship five or six boxes back from New York, and he said even in one box he even shipped a 289, I think that's 289 is right number, 289 V8 engine. He sent it back to himself. He had to make a reinforced box for it that fit inside their box, but there was no weight restrictions on them and things like that. I know a couple other guys that sent electric cement mixers. Another guy sent a big food grinder for their pigs and stuff like that. And another guy sent had a water pump sent to him, a big gasoline water pump. I'd love to have my dad send me a small hobby chainsaw. I just think of all the stuff I could do with that, how much time that would save us working. Just a little 10-inch McCullough or something would be fantastic. But if anybody has any information on those balik buy-in boxes, they could send me a message on YouTube or an email at blindowloutdoors@gmail.com. I'd really appreciate that. because I don't know, we could use the help. Thanks.